After signing Max Domi earlier today, the Leafs have extended Timothy Liljegren and some other news. We're going to talk about the Liljegren extension. We're going to talk about the qualifying offers that the Leafs extended to several players and the ones they didn't. And we're going to look ahead to tomorrow, Canada Day, July 1st, free agency day. First things first, Timothy Liljegren is a Leaf! And a rather expensive one. Let's talk about it. Now you might be saying to yourself, Steve, that's not very fair. Max Domi just signed an extension for more than what Liljegren got. Yeah. It's, what else though? Last year, Max Domi made $3 million against the cap. He just signed a 4-year extension at 3.75 against the cap. That is a raise of $750,000. Last year, Timothy Liljegren was in the final year of a contract that paid him $1.4 million against the cap. And he wasn't even an everyday player in their lineup. He was still the occasional healthy scratch. And his reward for all that is $3 million, a $1.6 million raise. I saw some people say, wow, they doubled his cap hit. No, they didn't. They more than doubled it. 1.6 is bigger than 1.4. I'm not great at math, but I do know that. So here's the thing with Timothy Liljegren. He's tantalizing. He's so deeply frustrating as a player. But he shows you signs. He shows you signs. And when he shows you signs, you're convinced he's arrived. There's been a narrative going around, and it's almost insulting. It is kind of insulting. The Leafs were worried about losing Timothy Liljegren because he could be their Gustav Forsling. Not he could be as good as Gustav Forsling for them, as in he could be as good as Gustav Forsling for somebody else. Because once upon a time, Forsling was on the Blackhawks, and the Blackhawks said, meh. And he wasn't a Blackhawk anymore. Then the Carolina Hurricanes, smart hockey team, they've had a lot of recent success, went meh, and they put Forsling on waivers. It wasn't until he joined the Florida Panthers, they were like, hey, this guy's pretty good, and gave him a whole boatload of money. But the money is still not, like, dude, he makes less than six. That's crazy. You saw him in the playoffs. He was unreal. They constantly had him matched against the best opponents, and then they won the Stanley Cup. Gustav Forsling is a Stanley Cup champion. If Liljegren becomes like 75% of Gus Forsling, this will be a good contract. But right now, he's got quite a bit of work to do on account of he's not even an everyday player on the Toronto Maple Leafs, or at least he hasn't been. But letting him walk for nothing, that would have been terrible asset management. And there was a deadline at 5 o'clock this late afternoon to give him and all the other restricted free agents on the team a qualifying offer. What, by the way, is a qualifying offer? As Puckpedia describes it, in order for a team to keep a player's restricted free agent status, they must provide a qualifying offer. If they do not provide a qualifying offer, the player becomes an unrestricted free agent. Qualifying offers must be provided to the player by the later of the Monday after the draft or June 25th. And then it goes into the qualifying offer requirements. Hold that thought for later in this video. So Liljegren and guys like Nick Robertson, Connor Dewar, they all needed a qualifying offer. And that's basically, I don't know, it's like a sign of good faith, kinda. It's not a contract. A qualifying offer basically allows you to just keep talking to the player and negotiating with them. Otherwise, they become an unrestricted free agent and they can go anywhere, and you don't want that. It doesn't make any sense. So, if Liljegren is not an everyday player on the Toronto Maple Leafs, then why did they bother keeping him? Besides, they're gonna go out and get a bunch of guys in free agency. I mean, what do they need Liljegren for? And they just got Tanev. I mean, what do they need Liljegren for? Well, here's a tweet from Darren Dreger. Liljegren agrees to a 2-year extension with Toronto at $3 million per. Leafs are still in on Oliver Ekman-Larsson. Ooh. Nikita Zadorov is likely too expensive. Ooh. They like Matt Roy. Ooh. But sounds like he may be headed in a different direction. Ooh. Hence, Liljegren provides some affordable insurance. Basically, the Leafs are in a position where, right now, if they sign Chris Tanev, and they have only a few hours left to do so, it'll be Tanev and Liljegren as the only right-handed shots in the lineup. And before you ask yourself, aren't you leaving out Connor Timmins? No, I'm not. I'm not leaving out Connor Timmins. The Leafs are. He is not going to be a top six player for this decor. And if he is, please provide a list of how many guys are injured. Here's what it is. At $3 million against the cap for the next 2 seasons, Timothy Liljegren has to be better. He has to take a step. There's no other option. at that amount of money, he has to be a bigger part of this team than he has been. We all know what he can do offensively. He can score the occasional goal, and his stretch passes out of the zone. Oh my gosh. Sometimes, a few times a season, he'll fire a javelin up the ice, and you're like, this guy could win the Norris. This guy's Erik Karlsson. And then you'll see him cough the puck up or just be a net front presence, or rather a net front absence, and you go, oh, there were a couple weeks in the late winter where Liljegren got an increased role in the lineup, and I went, he's arrived. Here he is. And as he's done a handful of times in his career in recent memory, down the stretch leading into the playoffs, you're like, where'd he go? Tim, where'd you go? There was one shift in particular in the Leafs-Bruins series that summed up the up and down of Timothy Liljegren all too perfectly. I don't remember who it was on, but Timothy Liljegren laid what might have been the biggest, nastiest, hardest check of his NHL career. Less than 5 seconds after laying that hit, he was demolished with the hardest, most violent, brutal body check he has ever taken in his NHL career by two guys, actually, at the same time. Listen, he's a right-handed shot. We've seen the potential there. The organization is very familiar with him. He's only 25 years old. He can get better, and he has to get better. Because I got bad news for you. There's no cavalry coming over the hills. None. Not in the prospect system. They just got Ben Danford. He was a first-round pick this year. He's not playing in the NHL for a few years, guys. Topi Niemelä is the closest thing the Leafs have to an even sort of ready defensive prospect who shoots right, and all the guys behind him there are no guys. And in terms of free agents, the only two guys the Leafs seem to be in on are Chris Tanev, whose rights they acquired at the second day of the draft yesterday, and Oliver Ekman-Larsson, who doesn't shoot right. Liljegren has to take a step. There's no other option. Now, here are the qualifying offers that the Leafs signed. And it's actually kind of dry. From the Leafs' official PR account, the Maple Leafs have extended qualifying offers to Nick Robertson, Alex Steeves, Connor Dewar, and Timothy Liljegren. That was obviously before they signed the big extension. The club did not extend a qualifying offer to Noah Gregor. So they announced that they're not qualifying Noah Gregor, which is fine, and I understand. The problem is he's not the only guy they're not qualifying. From Kyle Cushman, no qualifying offers for Noah Gregor, Keith Petruzzelli, who's a goalie in the minors, and Max Lajoie for the Maple Leafs. Why were Petruzzelli and Lajoie in the announcement? What did they ever do to us? Lajoie played NHL games last year. Petruzzelli, fine, you don't want to name everyone and his last name's got a lot of letters, but Lajoie? I don't know, I just thought that was a little dry. Anyway, I told you to save a thought because this affects what the Leafs can do tomorrow in free agency, and tonight, because they still have some other guys who they could sign tonight. Chris Tanev, they have his rights. Tyler Bertuzzi, they have his rights. They can sign these guys tonight. Basically, what Puckpedia says for the qualifying offer number that you give a player, if your contract last year, last season's contract, was between $750,000 and $999,000, a qualifying offer pays that player 105% of last year's deal, up to $1 million. If you go to a player's player card on Puckpedia, it actually says what their qualifying offer is supposed to be upon the expiry of their contract. And for Connor Dewar and Nick Robertson, who I'm focusing on mainly, it has those numbers. I'm not focusing on Alex Steeves because he wasn't a regular Leaf last year. Connor Dewar made $800,000 against the cap last year. Puckpedia says he's going to go up to $893,000. That's if he signs the qualifying deal. Nick Robertson made $797,000, and that will go up to $814,000 if he signs the qualifying deal. Now, we don't know if Dewar or Robertson are signing their qualifying offer. We don't know. They might sign for more than that, and there's also an option to sign less for that if you wanted. You might say, why would a player do it? Well, because they're going to sign like a multi-year deal, and it gives them a better shot at staying in the NHL. Players have done it before. But I bring this up because we need to look at how much money the Leafs actually have to spend on free agents tomorrow. Heck, I want to look at what they have to spend on their own guys. Tanev is a Leaf. They have his rights, and they need him. They don't have a full decor right now. Also, Tyler Bertuzzi. Where's he going? Hopefully Toronto. At what number? And you can say to yourself, well, the cap went up. The salary cap went up. Last year it was $83.5 million, $83.5 million, and this year it's going to be $88 million. That means the salary cap went up by $4.5 million. That means the Leafs have an extra $4.5 million. Except, unfortunately, no they don't. According to my calculations, let's look at the Leafs line by line and pair by pair. Matthew Nyes and Mitch Marner. They both make the same amount of money this upcoming season. Auston Matthews gets a raise. He gets a raise of $1,609,750. So subtract that from the 4.5. The second line, John Tavares, makes the same amount of money. Bobby McMahon, who you might have forgot, got a raise of $587,500. And William Nylander, this is the biggest one on the team, got a raise of $4,537,634. Where do I sign up for that? Third line, Kelly Yarncroke makes the same amount of money. Max Domi gets a raise of $750,000. And Nick Robertson, we don't know what his raise is, but unless he signs for less, he is going to get a raise because of his qualifying offer. We don't know the dollar amount, so an asterisk attached to Nick Robertson. Then there's the fourth line, whoever you have on it, Holmberg, Kampf, Reeves, they all make the same amount of money. Connor Dewar, again, because of his qualifying offer, likely gets a raise. Ignoring Nick Robertson and Connor Dewar, the Leafs forwards this upcoming season are going to make an additional $7,484,884 against the cap, and that's with adding nobody. And that number, by the way, does not include Tyler Bertuzzi at all. So they're going to be spending over $7 million more on forwards this year, not including Tyler Bertuzzi, without adding a single living, breathing human being. Let's look at the back end. Let's look at the defense. Morgan Rielly will make the same amount of money. Timothy Liljegren is going to get a $1.6 million raise. Jake McCabe is going to make the same amount of money. Simone Benoit is getting a $600,000 raise. By the way, let me throw this in there. I'm not saying that none of these players deserve the raises they're getting. Like, is Steve seriously sitting here griping about Bobby McMahon making 1.35 or Simone Benoit making 1.35? No, I'm not. I'm just pointing out the Leafs cap situation and wondering aloud if they can afford it. I'm throwing it in there to say that the Leafs, without adding to their decor, will be giving guys who played for them last year on their back end an extra $2.2 million against the cap. Some money free up? Yeah, of course some money frees up. TJ Brody is coming off the books. There's $5 million. John Klingberg, there's $4.5 million, except that's skewed. People are acting like John Klingberg was a Leaf all year last year. He played 14 games and then was LTIR'd into oblivion, even though it was retroactive. Then in net, we have Joseph Woll, and obviously Sammy is coming off the books. But for this upcoming season, the Toronto Maple Leafs will be awarding an additional $9,684,884 against the cap to players who they had last year. So even though the salary cap is going up by $4.5 million, because of those raises, the Leafs actually gain negative $184,884. So TJ Brody's $5 million cap hit coming off the books and the additional $4.5 million that the Leafs get against the cap and everyone get against the cap because the cap went up, that is wiped out by the raises that they handed out. Now, does that mean the Leafs have no more wiggle room? No, of course not. They have wiggle room. Sammy is coming off the books and there's other guys coming off the books as well. But keep in mind what I just told you, they still need to go out and re-sign Tyler Bertuzzi. And if they don't re-sign Tyler Bertuzzi, they have to replace him. And if they don't replace him with a free agent or a trade, they're going to have to replace him from within. And that's going to have to be either Nyes or Robertson or somebody else. This also doesn't include the money that the Leafs are going to be giving to Chris Tanev. How much money are they going to give Chris Tanev? How much money are they going to be able to give Oliver Ekman-Larsson? That's if they even get Oliver Ekman-Larsson. And, worth being concerned about, they only got one goalie. They need another goalie. Unless you're going to have Joseph Woll and a rookie back there, which you can do if you really want, you're going to need to sign a goalie like Laurent Brossoit, Anthony Stolarz, Cam Talbot, and that's probably going to cost you at least a few mil. Listen, the Leafs have chosen. Listen, unless the Leafs do something big tomorrow with a trade, getting rid of one of the core four, they've made their bet. Their bet is we're going to run the core back, and that's fine. They'll probably do well with that core. They usually do. They have a good regular season, they make the playoffs, and they have, well, competitive playoff series. They're always tight. But adding to this roster in free agency is going to be incredibly hard. And the only way it's going to work is if Craig Berube can find it in the players and the players can find it within themselves to be better this upcoming season. Because right now, looking at last year's roster, it looks like the Leafs are adding Tanev, which is good, adding Oliver Ekman-Larsson, which is good, and a backup goalie or tandem goalie, which is good. That's it. Now look, it's not even July 1st at the time I'm shooting this. They got lots of time. They can still do lots of moves. The team that the Leafs have today is not the team that they're going to have in October. But the team either has a lot of work to do or this is the team. So let me know what you think in the comment box down below. For now, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. Stay tuned to this channel and especially the SDPN YouTube channel. We're going to be churning out videos all day tomorrow. Canada Day, free agency day, and it's going to culminate with a one-hour stream starting at 5 o'clock Eastern on the SDPN YouTube channel. See you there.